In this video, we will look at particle physics, which is a field of physics which has existed for around 100 years, though one may argue that the beginning was in 1897 with the discovery of the electron, which was the first fundamental particle to be discovered. Back then, however, we still lived in a classical world which was quickly falling apart. As we know today, particle physics is rooted in quantum field theory, and it has taken decades to come to grips with this field. In this video, we will discuss some general aspects of particle physics and experiments. Today, physicists all over the world study this field, at least theoretically. Because particle physics takes place at scales below a nanometer and experiments require a lot of energy, it is only possible to make experiments at a few special places around the world. One of the most famous places for particle physics is at the Large Hadron Collider at CERN in Geneva, Switzerland. The field of particle physics quickly began to take shape in the 1930s from the ruins of the classical world. After the formulation of quantum mechanics around 1923 to 1926, the next step was to formulate relativistic quantum theory, which we now know as quantum field theory. In 1927, Paul Dirac came up with the first relativistic quantum equation called the Dirac equation. It turned out that this equation predicted antiparticles. This led many to believe that the equation was false, as such particles were not known to exist at that time. This, however, changed in 1931 when the positron, or anti-electron, was discovered. The issue of how the nucleus could be stable with a positively charged proton was resolved with the prediction of a new particle. This new particle, later named the Pi meson, was the first of a new class of particles called mesons. In the meantime, in the 1930s, people were puzzled about what actually was going on in beta decays, and this eventually led to the introduction and discovery of neutrinos. After the discovery of the Pi meson, it was thought that particle physics was more or less well understood, and now we know that they were only getting started on particle physics. In the following years, many new particles were discovered, and the relationship between the particles was only understood much later with the invention of quarks and the Standard Model, and eventually we got to where we are today. In particle physics, we use Feynman diagrams to describe different processes. However, things are a bit more complicated in real life than in the toy model, which we considered in the video about Feynman diagrams. First of all, in the real world we have a lot of particles to work with, and we can't just put any particles together. The key to figuring out what is allowed is conservation of quantum numbers. What comes in must come out. As discussed in the video about the Standard Model, we have three fundamental forces to work with in particle physics. We have the electromagnetic force, the weak force, and the strong force. We will see that the weak force is a bit special. In order for us to make a valid Feynman diagram, we must conserve the following quantum numbers: charge, color, baryon number, lepton number, and flavor. The latter two, however, comes with an asterisk. Lepton numbers may be a mix between generations in some special neutrino oscillation cases. The flavor quantum number is not conserved by the weak force, as it generally changes flavor. This means that the identity of particles can be changed, like an up quark changing into a down quark. Let us consider in more detail what it means to conserve charge and color. In Feynman diagrams of real particle physics, we denote fermions or matter with a solid line with an arrow. The arrow is to show the fermion current. If it goes forwards in time, it represents usual matter. But if it goes back in time, it represents antimatter. This flow must go one way, and this actually also conserves the Feynman number of any process, where antimatter has -1 and matter has +1 Feynman number. Now let us go back to charge conservation. A simple process to consider would be the repulsion between two electrons. We have two charged electrons coming in, and then they interact via a photon and then go out. We thus end up with two electrons in the end also. We therefore have a charge of -2 before and after. Now let us consider the conservation of color. This is sort of a charge associated with the strong force. Thus, it is only relevant for this force. We have three colors, red, blue and green, and the anti-colors of that. Only quarks have color, so we can consider the case with two incoming quarks, which interact via a gluon. Let's say one quark has a blue color and the other has a red color. The gluon can contain two colors, so the gluon will be blue and red. When the particles interact, the gluon will thus carry the red color to the blue particle, and the blue particle gives its blue color to the red particle. We thus have that the particles swap color, but color is conserved as we still have blue and red color before and after. Next, let us consider baryon and lepton number conservation. The baryon number of a baryon like a proton is 3 as it contains 3 quarks. Likewise, antiprotons have a baryon number of -3 as they contain 3 antiparticles. Mesons, which are made from quark-antiquark pairs, therefore have a baryon number of 0, which means you can make a lot of them in a reaction as they don't affect the baryon number conservation. An example of baryon number conservation is the beta minus decay. In this case, you start with a neutron, which is made from 2 down and 1 up quark, and therefore you have a baryon number of 3. One of the down quarks turn into an up quark, turning the neutron into a proton. This is a flavor change caused by the weak force, and we also end up with an electron and an electron antineutrino. From the point of view of baryon number conservation, everything is great. We start with a neutron and end with a proton, and both has baryon number 3, so things are good. Now the situation with lepton number conservation is more interesting. This decay was exactly what led to the prediction of the neutrino. First of all, this process only matches experimental data if there is a neutrino to give us the correct kinematics. But we can actually see that the lepton number conservation also demands that the neutrino must be there. In the beginning of the process, we only have a neutron, thus we have lepton number 0. But if we only had the electron afterwards, we would have plus 1 lepton number. Therefore, we must have an antineutrino to cancel this out. So with the antineutrino, we get 1 minus 1 is equal to 0, and lepton number is conserved. This process is also an example of how flavor is broken by the weak force. The W minus boson mediator in this case changes the flavor of the down quark into an up quark. It's great that we can set up some simple rules, figure out some processes and compute them. But how do we compare them to reality? How do we get from theory to a result which we can test in experiments? In particle physics, we can measure two things, decay rates and cross sections. Decay rates are rather simple and we denote decay rates with capital gamma. We simply figure out how much of some particle decays. From the decay rate, we can also find the mean lifetime, tau, using the simple relation, tau is equal to 1 over gamma. The full math of how we calculate decay rates is rather complicated, so let's skip to the results and take it from there. For the simple case where some particle decays into two different particles, the decay rate is gamma is equal to the absolute value of p divided by 8 pi m1 squared and all of that multiplied by the amplitude squared, where the absolute value of p is momentum of either of the outgoing particles. We also have that the mass of the particles which decays, called m1, and the amplitude of the process m. This part is calculated using the Feynman rules as discussed in the previous video. A real-life example of this process could be the decay of the W boson. The other thing we can look at is the cross-section of a scattering process. Since this process naturally involves two incoming and two outgoing particles at least, such processes are more complicated. In particle accelerators, one can smash particles together and make experiments regarding the cross-section of a process. It is often easier to work with the differential cross-section of a process, and this we write as d sigma divided by d omega is equal to dn divided by L d omega, where the script L is the luminosity and the dn is a number of particles and the d omega is the solid angle of the detector. And of course sigma is the cross section. If we could completely surround the process with a detector, this would reduce to n is equal to sigma L. where the event rate is equal to the cross section times the luminosity. For the scattering process of two different incoming and outgoing particles, one can obtain the theoretical result using the following equation. D sigma over d omega is equal to the amplitude squared divided by 64 times pi squared, and in parentheses, the energy of particle 1 plus the energy of particle 2, that squared, and then all that multiplied by the momentum of the outgoing particle divided by the momentum of an incoming particle, where E1 and E2 is the energy of the incoming particles respectively. We again have the amplitude, which must be calculated from the relevant diagrams using Feynman rules. The PF and PI is the momentum of either of the outgoing and incoming particles. One can thus compare the experimental and theoretical result to check if the theory holds, which it generally does. In this video, we have discussed a lot of different aspects of particle physics. The conservation of quantum numbers is deeply rooted in the math of the Standard Model, and in the videos about the different forces, we learn to master each of the forces and its Feynman rules. We will also understand that just by following the Feynman rules, then we will actually automatically conserve the different quantum numbers. If you have some interesting processes which we should cover in an upcoming video, please put it in the comments with any other feedback. As always, I hope you've learned something new. If you did, please like and subscribe. Feel free to support me and buy me a coffee using the link in the description. Stay tuned for more videos.